Good afternoon. Welcome as we gather to celebrate the life of and pay our last respects to Clara Angeline Sterling, who passed away peacefully on October the 23rd, 2018. My name is Brian. It's my privilege to host this evening. Welcome this afternoon. Each of you may have a program. If you don't, they are in the foyer just to help navigate the afternoon. And just a few reminders on housekeeping. In the foyer where you came in, there are some washrooms. If those are occupied, there are some downstairs in the basement. If I could ask you to make sure that your electronic devices are off, unless you're an emergency worker, just out of respect for this afternoon. Over your right-hand shoulder, right at the back, there is a nursery. So if you have a fussy child and you want to take them out, then that's a good place to take them. In the foyer where you came in, there's a visitor's book. If you could make sure just to write something in there. If you have already, thank you. If on our way down for refreshments afterwards, you can write something and that would be wonderful. Thank you. There's also a basket for cards, if you want to put cards in there. Downstairs, there's a display of Grandma Sterling's artwork and memorabilia. Feel free to have a look at that. It's not for taking home, it's just to look at. There are refreshments afterwards downstairs where you came into the entrance of the church. Instead of coming up the stairs, go down the stairs. And if you need some assistance, just get hold of Colin and he'll make sure that he operates the lift for those that have wheelchairs and have difficulty walking down the chairs. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come to you this afternoon to celebrate a life that was well lived. Each person that has come into contact with Grandma Sterling has been impacted in some way. We come to celebrate the good times, the bad times, life as we know it. Lord, I pray that as we hear from different people, as we hear different songs, poetry and so on, as we hear a message from your word about our state as human beings, I pray, Lord God, that you would be glorified, that we would remember Clara with much fondness and good memories. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to call Shirley Dirksen to come up and to read the eulogy.
Hello, everyone. I'm just going to introduce myself for some of you who might not know me. I am the daughter of Ed and Darlene Dirksen, and the granddaughter of Jim and Clara Sterling. And this is Kara. She is the great-granddaughter of Clara Sterling. So we're just both honored to be here and be able to tell you a little bit more about Grandma Sterling today. Clara Angeline Sterling. Grandma Clara was born on December 30th, 1925. On the homestead of her parents, Tom and Zora Pollard. She grew up on the farm, which was located in the Blaine Lake District of Saskatchewan. There was one brother and 10 sisters that made up the family. It was with them she learned the skills of cooking, cleaning, sewing, preserving foods, raising animals, and growing gardens. All of which she taught her own children later on in life. There were many hardships for families growing up in the Depression years, but this was made worse for the Pollard family when they lost their father when Grandma was only 10 years old. After finishing her schooling, she took a job as a waitress in a nearby town. It was there she met a young soldier returning from the war. They soon married and began a family of their own. Hardship continued to follow them through the years. In 1948, Grandma lost her home to the Fraser River flooding in Agassiz, BC. In 1963, Grandma lost her home to fire here in Richmond. But it was the good times in life and the will to make a better life for her family that got Grandma to move onwards. Later in her life, she would say it was the hard times that made her a stronger person. After raising her children, Grandma began working outside the home again. She was employed as a housekeeper here at our local hospital. She was a homemaker for many elderly people in Quesnel, and she volunteered with the Legion and palliative care for many years. When her husband passed away in 1988, she found herself traveling back to the prairies, visiting her brother and sisters quite often. It was with them and old friends that she got to share her faith in Jesus and encourage them to get to know the Lord. In her later years, she enjoyed her Bible studies, her artwork, craft making, and watching the Canucks on TV. Grandma was a special person, and she had an impact on all the lives she touched. She leaves with us many wonderful memories. I've been thinking this week about what kind of a legacy Grandma leaves behind. She definitely left an impact on everyone who knew her, but she didn't really have a global impact. She didn't acquire great wealth or fame, but I think what she will be remembered for the most was her kindness and her generosity. She would welcome anyone into her home. It didn't matter if they were rich or poor, and she would always offer you something. Grandma would not let a Christmas go by without buying presents for all of her kids, and her grandkids, and her great-grandkids. She would always offer you a cup of coffee or tea, and a cookie. The great-grandkids always knew her candy dish would be full. I think if Grandma was here, she would want to give you something to remember her for. And she would offer you her most valuable possession, Jesus. She would ask you, "Do you know Jesus?" Because knowing Jesus and loving him was what she cared about the most. I think she would tell you that there are a lot of things you can work for in life, but loving Jesus is the only thing that matters. So in Grandma's words, I want to ask you, do you know Jesus? If you don't, ask somebody to introduce you to him. And if you do know Jesus, then love him with all your heart and love each other. As a living legacy to Grandma, I encourage each of us to love Jesus and to love each other. Let's put aside our petty differences and just be kind and generous to each other. I love you, Grandma. Have fun loving Jesus.
Up here just for a few seconds because just as we reflect upon the words that Shirley shared with us and just about our memories that we have of Clara, of Grandma Sterling, Grandma Clara, whatever her term of endearment was for you, we're going to listen to one of her favorite songs by Johnny Cash, If We Ever Meet Again.
Soon we'll come to the end of life's journey, and perhaps we'll never meet anymore. Till we gather in heaven's bright city, far away on that beautiful shore. If we never meet again this side of heaven, as we struggle through this world and its strife, There's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the side of the river of life, where the roses bloom forever, and where separation comes no more. If we never meet again this side of heaven, I will meet you on that beautiful shore. Oh, they say we shall meet by the river, where no storm clouds ever darken the sky. And they say we'll be happy in heaven, in that wonderful sweet by and by. If we never meet again this side of heaven, as we struggle through this world and its strife, there's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the side of the river of life, where the roses bloom forever, and where separation comes no more. If we never meet again this side of heaven, I will meet you on that beautiful shore.
We're going to have a moment where you, if you have come prepared, and if you so wish, to share something about your memory with Grandma Sterling. And just to my right-hand side here, there's a microphone. Feel free to come up and to speak. If you have something that you've written down and you're really nervous about coming up here to read it, but you still want it read, then come and speak to me, and I'll read it for you, which is okay. We're gonna spend some time doing that. And as soon as it's quiet for too long, then I'll come up and we'll carry on with the next part of the memorial service. I want to get the ball rolling just with an amusing story. We visited Grandma Sterling a few times for tea and cake and sandwiches. And one day my wife Lisa went to Grandma Sterling by herself to go and have tea. Said, "You must come and have tea with me." So we did. And Lisa went there, and she had been there for quite a while having a conversation with Grandma Sterling, and she said, "Oh, I just love talking to you. I love hearing you talk. I don't understand the word you're saying, but I love your accent." So she just wanted to hear the South African accent. So they enjoyed the tea and just carried on speaking.
Brian actually told us, you got to sit in the front of the church because then you get up there right away. So hey, all that training came into time. I just wanted to share a memory about Grandma. I remember going to her little apartment and having tea as well with her and just talking about the Bible and talking about Jesus. She just loved the Lord. And she also just heard from the Lord, and she would pray for people. I'm sure that a lot of people here, she probably prayed for you at some point, and you had no idea she was even praying for you. A while back, actually, my wife had some medical issues, and we never really told a lot of people about it, and we were just praying about it, and Grandma, I was actually at a funeral, pulled Anne aside and said, "What is wrong with you? The Lord told me there's something wrong with you. What's the matter? I've been praying about it." And Anne was like, "Okay, I guess I'm going to have to tell Grandma exactly what's going on." But she already knew what was going on, and she was already praying about it. And that's what I just loved about Grandma. She loved the Lord, and she loved people, and she prayed for them. And Yeah, I just wanted to read one last thing here. Just a Psalm 23. The Lord is my best friend and my shepherd. I will always have more than enough. He offers a resting place for me in his luxurious love. He tracks me to an oasis of peace, the quiet brook of bliss. That's where he restores and receives my life. He opens before me the pathways to God's pleasure, and he leads me along in his footsteps of righteousness, so that I can bring honor to his name. Lord, even when your path takes me through the valley of the deepest darkness, fear will never conquer me, for you already have. You remain close to me and lead me through it all the way. Your authority is my strength and my peace. Love you, Grandma.
Follow the steps of those two. So just a blessing to see all of Mom's family here today, our church family. And I wasn't going to share, but I'm going to be brave because my mom was brave, eh? And anyhow, before she passed, I was digging in my cupboard. I collect cookbooks, eh? And I get it from all over the place. So I was looking for a recipe, and I found this letter. A poem, a letter from heaven. So it was so much like my mom, I had to share it with you today. To my dearest family, some things I'd like to say. Sounds like mom. First of all, to let you know that I've arrived okay. I'm writing this from heaven. Here I dwell with God above. Here there's no more tears of sadness. Here it's just eternal love. Please don't be unhappy just because I'm out of sight, for you will see me in the family. I left behind a smile, a joke, determination, a love for rocks, a tender giving heart, a skill with cards. There are many rocky roads ahead for you and many hills to climb. It was always my philosophy, and I'd like it for you too, that as you give unto the world will give to you. If you can help somebody who's in sorrow and pain, then you can say, to God at night, my day was not in vain. And since Mom's passing, we've been getting letters from people all over. People in the youth group that she used to counsel about boys. Parties she used to go to. People she would talk to in the bar. It was amazing. She just touched many lives. And now I'm contented, she says, that my life was worthwhile, knowing as I passed along the way, I made somebody smile. So if you meet somebody who's sad and feeling low, just lend a hand to pick them up as on your way you go. And when you're walking through life and think of me, remember what I told you about my Jesus. And when it's time for you to go from this body to be free, remember, you're not going, you're coming home to me. Thank you for loving me,
Thank you for being more than a mother-in-law to me. Thank you for making me feel like a part of your family right from the beginning. You always treated me with respect, kindness, and fairness. I love the way you always stood up for me. I think the only time you didn't take my side or any of your daughter-in-law's side was when it came to making making dinner for your son. That was just not right in your eyes. You spoiled those boys of yours, Mom. Mom, I want to thank you for all the things you taught me. When my mom wasn't here and she moved away to Kamloops, you were here for me. And you were here to teach me many things. And just living up the hill from me was such a blessing. You know, two doors down, I could just go there anytime. And I appreciate that so much. I thank you for helping me to be a cook and a baker and a sewer. And you loved all my creations. Whenever I made you something, you treasured it. And if I needed a cook for my brownie camp, you were there. If I needed costumes made for the Christmas play, you were there. So many ways you blessed me, Mom, and I thank you for that. Thank you for all the things you did for Lloyd and I and the boys. We have so many wonderful memories of our times with you. Our holidays to the Kootenays every summer when the boys were young were such special times. I will always remember watching you come back from milking those cows. I was a chicken when it comes to that, going out into the field, but she would come back from the pasture, and you'd come back with your milking clothes on and your big gum boots and a cigarette hanging out of your mouth. It was one of those rolly ones. You'd roll it, and it was about this thick, and my dad would have a chicken. All our trips to Terry fishing and you sleeping in your car, never you would sleep with us. No, you had to sleep in your car. Waking up with your hair standing straight up like Einstein. Or that other show that Patsy always says. Our trip with you and my mom to Whitehorse in your van, and many wonderful adventures we had with you two. You were such a blessing, Mom. But I just want to say thank you for always being there for me. You were my go-to person whenever I was struggling or feeling upset. You were always my teacher and my friend, and I loved that I could come and talk to you anytime. And when you gave your heart to the Lord, then you had a new thing to share with me. And I'm so grateful that when I gave my heart to the Lord, I had you to talk to about those things. You and I had a special bond, Mom, and I'll be forever grateful. Sometimes I lifted you up, but most of the time you lifted me up. But we had each other to talk to and pray with, and I thank you for that. Thank you for all the happy, fun things you did and all those memories we have of you. Playing cards, popcorn and jujubes was on the table. All the funny things you baked and all the substitutions you would put in that made us just laugh. Like brownies with jello on top. Cheesies for croutons and a Caesar salad. But Mom, you were such an example for all of us of what life is all about. Even when you had nothing and times were tough, you made do and provided for your family. Just like that old saying, when life gave you lemons, you made lemonade. Well, Mom, you made lemon pie. Your cup was always half full. I know you don't want us to dwell on the fact that you're gone, because you have wanted to go for a long time now. And that was not a bad thing. That's what you wanted. I found a poem about that, and I'll read it to you at the end. I will always remember, and I know Kathy will too, because that was a special time for us. When you said goodbye. You said goodbye to us before your surgery. I know God gave you that moment of being aware of what was going on, and your mind was clear. You knew you had to tell us, and we leaned in closer to listen, and you said, remember what I think and what I believe. You had to tell us and make sure we heard how much you loved us, and you had to tell us and how proud you were of all of us. And Kathy and I will hear that forever. You always made sure you said all of us. How proud you were of your kids and geniuses. And that was so special. We all have geniuses for kids. And that was such a special thing that you'd say about them. And you always were interested in what they were involved in. You went to hockey games and you went to swimming pools. And you did so much, Mom, and we love you for that. And Mom, we will always remember what you told us. Whenever we got together for your birthday or you had to say something, you always said, remember, trust in the Lord and everything will be okay. And that is what we're doing today, Mom. We are trusting in the Lord to help us walk through this because he has already walked you through it. And this is the poem that I found. Let him go, it's called. The angels gathered near your side, so very close to you, for they knew the pain and suffering that you were going through. I thought about so many things as I held tightly to your hand. Oh, I wish that you were strong and happy once again. But your eyes were looking homeward to that place beyond the sky where Jesus held his outstretched arms. It was time to say goodbye. I struggled with my selfish thoughts, for I wanted you to stay so we could walk and talk again like we did just yesterday. But Jesus knew the answer, and I knew you loved him so. So I gave to you life's greatest gift, the gift of letting go.
Apologize for some of my grandma's words. They're hers, not mine. So I heard my dad was writing a poem for grandma's funeral, so I thought that was the best way we could get our memories across as well. Bring it out. Stop shaking first, okay? Alright, we called the poem. I'll never forget the times. I'll never forget the times we spent on the slanted bed sleepovers of Grandma and my two sisters.
Watching Jeopardy, Rescue 911, Unsolved Mysteries, and the very first Simpsons Next episode.
The endless orange Tic Tacs.
Walking home from school and noticing she was always watching us through her kitchen window. Don't cut through the grass, walk up the driveway.
The time Grandma said farting is healthy. Get there. She also said, if you're going to keep that up, put some paper between your cheeks so I don't have to hear it.
All the times as a kid searching for snacks, but you could never tell what it was because everything in the cupboard was in an old blue Safeway package.
The memories of her teeth just chilling at the bathroom sink.
The always full tin box of cookies.
The leftover pancakes, which we ate spam and onion sandwiches.
The slacks and blouses, she loved wearing them both.
All the times I heard, oh, it's so nice to see you, Corey. You've gained weight.
The one day she made us pick Downy Lines for soup. But now I know we were just being annoying.
The 30-year-old stuffed pink husky.
Having your feet massaged and it's feeling so amazing, and then telling you that there's something wrong with you.
The time being scared after realizing he ate every single strawberry in the garden.
The 6 month puzzle project.
The time I couldn't resist licking the frozen water drop.
The trend when she used Bear Grease on anything and everything.
Bringing home my best gift ever, a unicycle.
The countless games of war.
The story when Grandma was telling us about the friendly bus driver that waved at her. But then Dad afterwards said that she cut the bus off and he was fingering me.
The legendary candy dish.
The one and only time I remember her yelling, and it was because Richard and Kelly were fist fighting in Grandpa's old bed.
The time spent searching for treasures in her kitchen junk drawer.
Okay, I lied. I remember another time when she caught Uncle Barry peeing all over Uncle Tom's truck because Graham had peed on his truck tire.
The time she made us eat liver. Pretty sure we haven't tried it since.
The time a buddy told me about the time he'd seen a bear rummaging around in the front ditch of his house out on Dale Lake Road. But it wasn't a bear. He then told me it was a little old lady picking Saskatoon.
All the times Grandma spent digging through the freezer for dessert and being so happy because she found a tub of vanilla ice cream that she didn't remember buying.
The constant reminders to the girls that they need to treat their men better. Thank you, Grandma.
The time she jumped on a bike and took off like it hadn't been 25 years.
The time when I came home from school one day to witness Grandma roll painting the hood of her car, then adding duct tape pinstripes to boot.
The life lessons, every visit.
Her friend Sam.
The road trips in the old gray van and multiple camping trips to Tenmile Lake.
The time spent throwing darts into the wall, not actually into the dartboard.
The cook-a-tree trip and the great mosquito infestation at Auntie Jean's house in Villain Lake.
The fact that the George's dog Bobby, I'm sure, only took dumps near her back door.
Cookie shopping and her buying 6 boxes of cookies because she wanted them all and it's her money.
The several times being called you little Dickens. The time my mom phoned and told me that Grandma was slowly losing her mind. But I replied, that's wrong, Mom. She's been calling me Shelly since I was a little boy. I guess this one happened multiple times. The time I took Chelsea over to Grandma's for supper and she served Caesar salad with Cheetos for croutons. And one of the last times visiting with Grandma, we were talking, sitting around chatting, and I was telling her about me being in engineering school. She puts her hands together, like she always did. She's like, hey, Corey, why do you want to drive trains?
Watching her hair at the hospital just in case a gentleman came calling. Saying I love you, Grandma, and her yelling very loudly, startling the nurse and myself, I love you too!
So after writing all this down, I kind of figured like some people might think Grandma was a little crazy at times, but I just figured she just had stopped. Listen, Grandma.
it's wonderful to see so many of Clara's family and friends. And every age is, I think, represented here. Because really, she was interested in everyone. Today marks the day that I have often thought about. You might find that strange, but I've known Clara for over 30 years. And she wasn't all that young when I met her. She was, you know, pretty much 60. So it is many more. How many years is God going to give her? So a long time ago, my husband and I used to talk about this very day when we would officially say goodbye to Clara. Neither of us were looking forward to it. We didn't know when it would come. But then my mind would go to Clara's attitude about life and death. She's been telling me for years, as you've heard, that she was ready to go, and she didn't understand the holdup. Like, why not? I'm ready. Many, many times she said, it can be any time. As a longtime friend and when one of her many adopted daughters, it's really my great honor and privilege to share some truths about Clara. As you've heard already, she was a special, fun individual. She was different. She made you laugh. Sometimes she made you cry. But you were never indifferent. She was a special treasure. And the Bible says in Psalm 139:14 that she, like all of us, were wonderfully made. I would get no arguments there. Right from her youth, she was hardworking, unselfish, responsible, and caring. I think that sparkle in her eye was even evident then. She grew up early when her dad fell sick and died when she was only 10. And she grew up, as we've heard, in very lean times. It wasn't easy with 11 kids and a mom. We had to work together to get by. As a young woman, wife, and mother, her unselfish servant nature just continued to bloom. Her highest ambition appeared to be to provide a loving, nurturing home where her family felt loved and treasured. She took this role very seriously, teaching her kids honesty, kindness, unselfishness, to serve, respect, generosity, and hospitality, just to name some things that I think are very evident in her family. She was known for her rich hospitality, and you heard like food was important. No matter her finances or her age, right up to, well, weeks before she died, she would be inviting you over for tea. Come on over. Tea was tea and cookies or cake or whatever else was in the fridge covered up would get pulled out. So her door was always open to friends, and she was always ready and willing to cook or bake for anyone needing food. She was always bringing cookies for the kids for Sunday school because they really needed sugar in Sunday school. I remember her whenever I see deviled eggs on buns, on half a bun, right? That was one of her go-to recipes. And we had that after her internment at Sharon and Lloyd's house. She also made strawberry tarts. I think there might be a few of those downstairs too. We couldn't forget that. And her homemade jam and her biscuits. So there's a few of those downstairs too. Help us remember. She always had homemade jam and her biscuits. Even at 90 years old, she was still getting up early, and I mean early, on Sunday mornings so that she could, from scratch, make tea biscuits to take to Bible study. You know, she was about 90 at the time. And I was realizing that it was really hard on her to upset her schedule and have to get up early, and then she'd think about having to get up early, and that would make her sleep a little worse. Finally, I thought, you know, I've got to do something about this, because sometimes it was just too tiring for her, even though her heart was in it. So finally, I had to say to her, Claire, we're not going to eat there anymore. Oh, well, maybe that would be okay then. So that was the end of eating at Bible study. Just so she didn't have to get up so early, because they had to be hot, and they had to be new, fresh out of the oven. To Clara, food was love. And she loved well. She was a generous and grateful woman. She saw a need, and she didn't wait to be asked for help before acting. I was only one of the many who found that we lost arguments with Clara about taking gas money, or, as she liked to call it, a little treat money. We would find money stuffed in our pockets or our pocket, because she just wasn't going to take no for an answer. She would put it somewhere. Sometimes she wouldn't find it for weeks. But she wanted to bless, because she was a giver. She was generous no matter what her circumstances. I think that was because she was content. The Bible says in Philippians 4:11-13, I am content with whatever I have. I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I have learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it's with a full stomach or empty, with plenty or little, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. When I say Clara was grateful, she didn't even take the beauties of life for granted. She looked around, and she noticed everything, even new white lines that were painted on the highway. Who noticed? She says, isn't it nice? It just brightens up the whole road. New lines. Okay. She always gave God praise and thanks for his beautiful creation. I never failed to enjoy exclamations about the trees, what state they were in, the clouds, she loved a good cloud, or meadows as we passed, driving back and forth. She saw the beauty of God's creation, and in her senior years, her artistic talent moved from quilting and sewing and knitting to skills that nobody knew Clara really ever had. She started to paint. And it wasn't enough to just paint. She would find rocks to paint. And she could look at that rock or that piece of wood and say, that's a bird. And I'll tell you what kind of bird it is. Because she was used to looking at the birds and the bird feeders she had. And she put her passion into painting. She amazed us. She was a rock hound of rock hounds. And we're not talking pebbles here. She wanted big rocks because she had ducks to paint out of those rocks, or birds, or fish. She just amazed us. Claire was a hard-working, cheerful servant. In Romans 12:9-11, it says, don't just pretend that you love others. Really love them. Hate what is wrong. Stand on the side. Good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lazy in your work, but serve the Lord enthusiastically. Clara did that for all of her days. She was still working in the church kitchen up until about 2 years ago when it got hard to come to church. She'd be the last one in there with the tea towel, drying dishes, clearing tables. I would try to avoid telling her that it was our turn, because I thought, you know, it's just too hard on her. So even if I didn't tell her, but then she saw somebody from her life group, whoo, she's in there. And she would be the last one to leave. That's just who she was. She was thrifty and capable. I've heard stories about how she re-knit yarn into new mittens and socks. She remade clothing out of somebody else's old clothes. As we heard, she learned to bake, cook, can, do jams and jellies, sew, knit, and manage a household. And she did that well. She learned how to capably run a farm when they didn't even have running water. She knew how to stretch a penny, but she was never stingy. Her family would always come first. She worked diligently inside the home, but also worked, as we heard before, as a hospital housekeeper and a home care worker for seniors in her later life. And it wasn't a stretch to see her in those jobs outside the home, especially when she was doing home care workers for seniors, because she could encourage them there. She could put a little good news into their life that day when she came to look after their needs. And Clara was proud. I don't mean prideful. She was so proud. Not of herself, of her family. I don't think I ever heard her refer to any of her children without hearing a "my" in front of their name. I heard about my Lloyd and my Darlene and my Kathy and my Tom and my Rick. My was always touched first because her children were always her most precious treasures. And as we've heard, she always had good stories because she stayed connected to her grandkids and to her great-grandkids. If there was a son or daughter with her that would take her to sports day and the pool and to hockey practices and games, she was there. Clara was a good listener, and she had good counsel to share. Her kids told me that they could share anything with her, and she always lovingly listened. She didn't always agree, but that was okay, because they knew that she believed in them, and she loved them. So she would listen and advise. She was also a faithful friend and a loyal friend who kept confidences and promises. And she was such a good encourager. I remember being on the end of encouragement with her after my husband died. She must have thought to herself, Dan Robert doesn't have the phone ring very much anymore. And she used to phone me up and say, "And how are you really doing?" Because she had a compassionate heart. She wanted to help you feel better. Proverbs 31:26 says, "When she speaks, her words are wise, and she gives instructions with kindness." That's how Clara lived. My son reminded me yesterday. He said, "I would have come. It's too bad that it's just so far away." And I said, "How would you like to hear what I'm going to say?" So he said, "Sure." And then when he was finished, he said to me, "Oh, you sound just like Dad would have said." And then he said to me, "But don't forget to say that we all called her Grandma Sterling. It didn't matter what age we were. If people my age that were only, 20, 25 years less, we called her Grandma Sterling too. She was a grandma to all of us. And she pulled us in. She spread her love and influence everywhere she went. And as Darlene mentioned, she's still getting notes and stories that people are writing down of how her life touched their lives. Just as the Bible says that the older women should teach the younger, Clara took the women under her wing, and she taught them how to walk and behave like Christian women. She believed and taught her daughters and adopted daughters that you should take care of your home. We've heard that before. And your men. And do it well. And take care of your own appearance. And put your best foot forward. Clara was never seen out without her hair done, wearing neat, attractive clothing with her blouse and four trail pants. And she always had to have some nice jewelry on that matched. A little rouge, maybe, and a little lipstick. It was important to her. She wanted to look good when you looked at her. It makes you feel better when you look at somebody that's taking care of themselves. She taught that you should care about how you look and how you take care of your home and possessions that God gave you. And even in her last month, she was heard asking for thread to mend the hole a mouse had made in her pouch. It was no big deal. Her first thought was, we just need to fix it. Where's the thread? So a mouse chewed it. We can fix it. Clara was just like her Jesus in so many ways. Just as Clara took old things and lovingly made them into something new and useful, Jesus takes the old sinful us and remakes us into something clean, purposeful, and free. He did that for Clara when she was 61 years old. Clara found out that she could move from knowing about Jesus to really knowing him. She chose to confess her sins and believe that Jesus died on the cross for her so that her sins would be paid in full. She looked forward to the gift of eternal life with Jesus after her earthly life was over. She also made a decision at that time that she was going to follow Jesus, who was raised from the dead and sits on the right hand of God in heaven. Jesus became her Lord and her Master. Her life changed. She was often heard saying, I wish it hadn't taken so long. And at that point, things turned around. God became her priority. And everything else followed, only with even a bigger impact of love. Just as Clara looked around and appreciated God's creation, God Almighty looks on all of us with compassion and love, longing to have a personal relationship with his most important creation, mankind. He wants us to put our trust and hope in him alone. Sin is what separates us from God. In Romans 6:23, it says, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. And in John 3:16-18, it said, this is how much God loved the world. He gave his Son, his one and only Son, and this is why, so that no one need be destroyed by believing in him. Anyone can have a whole and lasting life. God didn't go to all the trouble of sending his Son merely to point an accusing finger, telling the world how bad it was. He came to help, to put the world right again. Anyone who trusts in him is acquitted. Anyone who refuses to trust in him has long since been under this death sentence without knowing it. And why? Because of that person's failure to believe in the one-of-a-kind Son of God was introduced to him. One of the ways that Clara's life changed is that she had the ultimate good news. She loved to tell you good news, but now she had the good news, and that was the news about Jesus, and she could share it. She wanted to tell the people that she loved, that she had been given a new life, a free, abundant life, and because this was the most important gift she could ever receive, she wanted everyone she loved to know Jesus too. She even packed up her old camper van and traveled east to the prairies to visit with family and tell them the news. My husband and I used to call those trips her missionary journeys, and I really believe they were. Clara told them she was free from condemnation and the power of darkness and Satan, and that she lived now with a freedom because she could live in God's kingdom. She was a saint of God. Because Clara knew Jesus, she also became a woman of prayer. We heard a little bit about that. She learned that she could give every care and problem to the Lord. She would ask him to continue changing her old self into one that acted and thought like her Lord. She would pray for wisdom and understanding because she could give good advice. She would lift up her family members, her friends, and even strangers she would hear about. Whoever the Holy Spirit put on her heart, well, that's what she would pray for. She was what we would call an intercessor, somebody that's called to pray much. And they could pray about anything, anybody, any place in the world. She could be watching the news and feel like she was supposed to pray for a situation. Many nighttime hours were filled with her petitions as she called out to God. Whenever you prayed with Clara, you knew you would hear her praying in agreement, saying, "Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord." And we, family, also noticed often if they walked in or she was praying, she would have hands like this, just like a child, praying in reverence to her Lord. She was also a woman who enjoyed fun. She loved camp, fish, paint. Because she enjoyed fun, she was always ready with a funny comment or an unexpected story. She loved to laugh with that little giggle and that twinkle in her eye. I used to say one of the things I most enjoyed about our ladies' Bible study was that I could always pass one laugh. And often, Clara was the one that gave it to us. Sometimes she would come out with the unexpected, just like we heard. Sometimes startling, but laughing. The Bible says that a merry heart does good like a medicine. Well, Claire was excellent in medicine. I was going to share something that I thought I'd be up here anyways. At the last location where she was able to go to our ladies' Bible study was at a lady's house that was shut in. And we would go back and forth. Her husband was where we were, was quite sickly as well. He didn't know the Lord yet. He would lay on the couch in the living room while we were in the kitchen. And if he was there with the blanket pulled up around him, Claire could not walk by without walking over and grabbing him on the toe. And then she'd look at me and say, "Jan, we need to pray for him right now." And you know what? He let us. Because he saw. He saw the heart in Clara to bless him, and he would take it. We would do the dishes. Clara would stand there and dry dishes, because we would do up about 3 or 4 days worth of dishes every Monday. And she wasn't going to sit down and just watch. She was going to stand there and help. Clara was a woman who was courageous. She didn't shirk from problems. And as you heard Shelley give the eulogy, how many people lose a home to flooding and then years later lose a home again to fire? She knew what problems were, but she had wisdom and strength as her allies, and especially after she knew the Lord. She knew that strength and joy were a gift from the Lord. She was spunky and no one to be pushed around. She was even seen chasing a bear with the broom. I know, maybe not the brightest, but you know what? That bear never came back. Her courage was evident as she offered forgiveness that could never be earned, because she had so much love and kindness in her. She met difficult life changes with resolve and faith and hope for a better day. She got through a triple heart bypass, she got through a broken hip, and every time life was a little different afterwards. But she went with it, and she didn't complain. She just went with it and accepted it. When I think of Claire, I think of someone who lived with much evidence of her faith. The Bible calls this evidence fruit. In Galatians 5, 22 to 25, it says, the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There's no law against these things. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passions and desires of their sinful natures to his cross and crucified them there. Since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. In closing, I want to say thank you, Jesus, for giving us 92 years with your daughter, Clara. It was time well spent. I also want to humbly ask you to examine your own hearts today and think about Jesus. Think about your need for him. He's calling your name right now. And if you seek him, you will find him, and you will receive the ultimate gift of salvation. This gift was what Clara most wanted you to share with her. She wanted to spend eternity with you in heaven, celebrating Jesus. Let's just pray together. Lord Jesus, I just say thank you again. Thank you, you gave this many years to this daughter. Lord, you helped her influence us in the ways of God. You helped her mold her kids' lives and have such a wonderful legacy in kids that grew up knowing right from wrong. Lord, we just thank you that she had an opportunity to share what you had done for her, that you'd healed her, that you'd made her strong, that you got her up every day, even when she thought she should have been in heaven long ago. You gave her the strength and the hope in today and every day to keep going. Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ. Thank you that you died on the cross for us, and that was payment for all the sins of the world. We just need to reach out and say, I'm sorry, Lord. Please forgive me for my sins. And accept that you died for us and paid for each sin that we will ever have or do in the future. Thank you, Lord, that we can follow you and you can show us your way like you did for Clara. Lord, we thank you that you can give us a new heart and new hope. Just thank you, Lord, for this saint. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay. We're going to watch a memorial slideshow presentation on the screen here.
That's an old picture. That's the mother and dad. And that's your grandpa, Jim, when he was little.
Oh.
My name,
it's Clara
Angeline
Pollard.
And now I am Mrs. Jim Sterling. My parents was Zora, and my dad's name was William. And it was Tom William. There was 11 of us children. They raised 11 of us. I was born in Blaine Lake, Saskatchewan. But I was born right at home. We didn't go to hospitals or anything. And my mother was a midwife. She was like a nurse that went around. Anybody who was having a baby, mother would go and be the nurse. I left home to go to work in Shelburne, Saskatchewan. And you see, there was Blaine Lake, then there was Marshall, Leask, and then Shelburne. And I went to Shelburne, and I was working as a waitress. And that's where I met Jim.
Yeah.
we were at his home. And anyway, he brought me an engagement ring. He says, well, we're going to get married. I think that's how he said. He says, we're going to get married. He says, I got something for you here. And so then he opened it up and gave it to me.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're going to rock around the clock tonight. Put your glad rags on. Join me home. We'll have some fun when the clock strikes one. We're going to rock around.
And of course, and we lived, the year we were married, we lived in his mom and dad's yard. And he helped with the chores, and we had a little, it was just the old house. They had a new house, and we lived in a little old house for 1 year, yeah. And then we got married in the fall, and then you see, in the spring, I had Lloyd. So when the baby come, well, we moved into town. We moved into town, yeah. I had the 5 children. Rick is the youngest, and then Tom, you see. Yeah, they have Kathy. And then there's Darlene, and Lloyd is the first one, yeah. 11-2, and before too long, we had our own quarter section of land and a house. And we lived there for quite a few years. I can't exactly remember how many years it was, but I know it was quite a few. Lost her home by fire, moved to Hills, B.C. After we moved into a farm home at Hills, B.C.
Let me tell you about a place somewhere up in New York way, where the people are so gay, twisting the night away. Twistin', they're twistin' the night away. Here's a man in evening clothes. How he got here, I don't know. But man, you ought to see him go.
I always like my gardens. I'm very proud of all my gardens. And the better they are, the better I like it. See my tomatoes over there?
Ooh, yeah.
I have one tomato plant. I got eight tomatoes off of it, but that's some of them. But I still like to see things grow. I like to see things grow. What do I expect of you, children? That you have health and that there'll be love and joy in your lives, and that you keep your mind on the Lord. You keep your mind on the Lord, and you'll come through with flying colors.
Wonderful. I think Alyssa Brookson put that together. And if you want a copy of that, just speak to Anne. That's Colin's wife in the corner here. And she'll, for a small fee of $100, no, she'll give you a copy of that, and so you can see it again if you wish. That was very well done. Behind me, we come to the end of our service, and I thought it would be good for us to pray together. And you can stay seated if you want. If you don't know the prayer, maybe you want to keep your eyes open so you can pray with me. And I thought it would be good for us to pray the Lord's Prayer together. And then I'm going to pray the benediction. And we're going to do one or two things after that. And then we're going to go downstairs. All right, so let's pray together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God our Savior be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. On behalf of the family, thank you for coming and showing your love and care today. Please join us downstairs for some refreshments. As we leave, we'll play one of Grandma Sterling's favorite songs.
Hello out there, we're on the air, it's hockey night tonight. Tension grows, the whistle blows, and the puck goes down the ice. The goalie jumps and the players bump and the fans all go insane. Someone roars, Bobby scores at the good old hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. Second period, where players dash with skates aflash, the home team trails behind. But they grab the puck and go bursting up, and they're down across the line. They storm the crease like bumblebees, they travel like a burning flame. We see them slide the puck inside, it's a 1-1 hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. Third period, last game in the playoffs too. Oh, take me where the hockey players face off down the rink, and the Stanley Cup is all filled up for the champs who win the drink. Now the final flick of a hockey stick and a one gigantic scream. The puck is in, the home team wins the good old hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old